So good evening, one and
Yes,
all present over here,
okay, so
and
let us start.
I welcome you all for this 5 days virtual seminar. So today we have our alumni, one of our alumni, Dr. Deepak Kumar Pradhan. So let me introduce about Deepak, then we'll start the seminar. So Deepak did his BSc from Institute of Mathematics and Applications from 2006 to 2009. Then he had done his MSc from University of Hyderabad. So then he completed his PhD from IIT Kanpur in 2018 in operational theory. So recently he is a postdoc at ISI Bangalore. And today he will speak on a keen to peak in Neverland interpolation. So thank you. Over to Deepak, please.
Thank you, Indra, for the introduction. Before we start, I would request Swajan sir to. So I hope all of you can see this picture, which is on screen, right? So I just want Swajan sir to tell us a story about this picture. So he told us a story, not one time, like many times, and whoever like has been with Swajan sir for some time must have heard it from him. So sir, can you just tell us something about the blind man and an elephant?
Yeah, there's an old story where seven blind men and went and found trying tried to find out how an elephant is like. One who, which caught hold of the trunk said it's like a snake, and one who looked at the ear said it's like a window fan, and then one who looked at the tail they said it is like a rope, and one who looked at the, caught hold of the leg, he said it's like a pillar, and one who touched the body said it is like a wall. Like this, they went on and on, but none of it really means anything, because this idea of the story is that it is only just seeing one aspect of the big thing, which is which you have to look at. I don't know. I should say a few things more words about Deepak. Deepak is the first batch of our AMA BSc program. And interestingly, four of them, that is Deepak, Tushar, Alok, and Snigdha, they have done their PhD already, and other two are there are two more girls, and there is another.
Siddharth,
Yeah, Siddharth Das, but he went to London to do his MS, and he is working in software or something.
yeah, he's working in Amazon right now. So I just met him last month, a couple of months back. Yeah.
Where is he?
So he is in Bangalore. He is working with Amazon.
I see.
Yeah. So basically, operation research stuff. So yeah. Go ahead. So.
Another boy, what's his name?
Ashutosh is teaching. I mean, he's a state government teacher, a
Yeah.
school teacher. So yeah. Yeah. So anyway, so just so thanks, sir, for reminding me of the IMA days. And this story is, so I'll take slightly longer, I guess. I will not finish exactly in 1 hour. So maybe a little longer, because this is very informal. There is no pressure on anybody to really think too much into it. Anyway, so the story, as I said, is blind man. I mean, slight correction, not looking up to it, but touching and trying, trying to guess what this object is. So basically, they can't see the elephant, and they're trying to guess what the object is. And from our perspective, none of the things that they described is correct, because it's neither a snake nor a rope or a trunk or nothing like that. But it is because of our vantage point that we can see the elephant that we can say that none of them is correct. But in their own view, they thought what they are describing is correct. So this is like looking at one picture, but I mean there is always keep this is okay. So what does this have to do with maths, first of all? So the thing is, we have to keep a bigger picture in mind. So what we do, we are looking at an aspect of a particular topic or a particular object, so to say, in mathematics. And today's object that I picked up is called Pick-Navalny interpolation. I'll just go to writing mode now. So I hope all of you can see the screen. I mean, the screen was visible, but let me see, the writing is visible as well. So so I guess this is okay. Let's keep it a bit bigger. Yeah. So this is visible. Oh, sorry. This I don't want to be. So so today I want to talk about, oh, there's an N here, Navalny interpolation. Okay. So this is the thing that I wanted to talk about. I just tried to do a very bad wordplay with this and said peak into peak Navalny interpolation. So have any of you has heard, I mean, okay, so the webinars are difficult to interact with. So I guess most of you have, might not have heard about this, but some of you might have heard about peak, as in complex analysis Clausius-Peak lemma. And some of you might have heard about Navalny as well, this Navalny theory of complex analysis. And then there is this interpolation that I'm going to talk about. So there are two aspects of what I'm going to talk. So first is this complex analysis part. So this is something I'll spend most of the time, because the second aspect is a bit more technical, because it's going to deal with Hilbert space and operator, particularly some kind of operators on Hilbert space. So, and how this interpolation actually links these two subjects. And towards the end of the talk, probably I'll say what the elephant is in this room. So let's start this with what is an interpolation. So I'll knowingly will be a little vague, so that you really don't have to stress yourself to understand. Just appreciate what's going on a bit, so that's enough. So what is an interpolation? So we have a set of, let's say, data points. I mean this. Okay, so this this may belong, all of these may belong to some set omega, and you have, let's say, omega 1, because I'm at two sets right now. So and you start with some different set of, these are called target points. Okay, so we have omega 2, and we have a class of functions. Okay, so f, the script f is a class of functions. So we have a class of functions which is from omega 1 to omega 2. And what we want is an interpolant. So what we want is to find a function f which is in this class, okay, and such that it will take each zi to wi for I equals to 1 to n, of course. Okay, so I'll just write like this. Huh. So what is going on here? So this is a very vague question to ask. Like, I'm giving you some point somewhere and some point somewhere else, and I have a class of functions, and I want to know whether there is an interpolant or not. Or, I mean, I have not stated the question also. So let's just see the question. What does the question actually means? So there are, in any case, when you have to solve something, there are three aspects of it. First of all is solvability. So whether we can solve a problem, whether we can do this in this framework given. So these two are given to us. Okay. So given these two things, when can we say we can solve this? We can find an f, right? So this, that is the solvability. Once you know there is a solution, we try to look at the qualitative aspect of the solution. For example, we want to look at the uniqueness of the solution, when the solution is unique, or up to what condition the solution is unique, right? And third is probably much more difficult sometimes, that actually giving a method, or so to say, an algorithm to find it, method to find. Okay, so these three aspects are something that we usually look at. Okay, so today in this Pick-Navalny interpolation problem, we'll just talk about solvability and vaguely look at uniqueness. method to find is not, I'm not going to touch upon that. So let's start with complex analysis first. So I'm assuming that most of the people are not aware of complex analysis as to say, but they are aware of complex numbers at the least. So that's what I'm assuming, and I'll just give you some background, like what's going on here and there, and there won't be any proofs, but okay, so complex analysis itself is like this elephant that we described. There are many aspects of looking at complex analysis and different point of view, and they're very interesting, all of them. So I'll just, let me just fix some notations here. So this C, this is C with a bar in the middle here, is called, is for a set of complex number. Okay. Now, this notation is very free in the sense that sometimes we write C as a set of complex number. It will also be the set of, it will be also a field, vector space over C itself, and so many other things, but this is fixed, this is C itself. And what is C? So if you, something is in C, then C, that element has to be of the form X plus IY, where your X and Y both are real numbers, and I is that square root of positive square root of negative one. Okay, so here, if you fix this, you have one description of a complex number. As I said, just one description of complex number. There are other descriptions as well. Now let's look at this. Okay, so the set has some interesting properties right now, which I want to see. One particular property is one can define a modulus, which is okay so let me just take the positive square root here. So if you look at this, this is your Euclidean, what you say, the Euclidean distance. If you're looking at X and Y independently, for example, this description tells you that there is a correspondence between complex number to the R2 or 2D, so to say, if, for people who are, have done 2D geometry in the 12th. So this is just from C to R2, and that is Z will be taken to X, Y. And here you see this is nothing but the Euclidean distance from 0 to X, Y. Okay, so this is our norm, or this is our modulus. Okay, so this modulus is going to play a big role. And basically what you can do, you can define a distance between any two points. Okay, so this can be defined using this norm. So basically, so what you do is, so let's say you can, I can write X1 minus X2 square plus Y1 minus Y2 square. Okay, so you do this, and okay, so this is how you, one can define this distance, and these two are going to be interesting for analysis point of view, because we, now we have a set, and now we have a distance defined on this. So we have a distance defined on this. So this is the distance, or it's called a metric or distance, or I mean, people might have, you must have seen different version of this as metric or a distance or whatever you want to call it, but metric is a preferred term. So let me call it metric as well. Okay, so now there is something, a particular set that I'll be talking about, which is called a disk. So the disk is defined to be all complex numbers which modulus is less, strictly less than one. Okay, so this is a open, it's called an open unit disk. Okay, open unit disk. So unit is, of course, the modulus is strictly less than one. Open, okay, at this point, by open, I mean the, if you draw the disk, I don't want the boundary of it. Okay, my disk does not really look like a disk, but okay, so you can, take out the boundary. Okay, so the circle, the boundary is not there. So that is what I mean by open right now. We'll see another, we'll see what else we can talk about openness. But what we want to do is analysis on this particular object. What we want to do is to define derivatives. Right? So once you have the distance, you are, for people who have seen limit in calculus in school, you know that if there's a modulus, we usually tend to look at limits. So here we can, once you have limits, you can actually talk about derivatives. with some, of course, not just limit. You want to also have division, multiplication, and so on and so forth. So let's talk about what is a differentiable function. So let omega be a subset of C. Right now, I'll just write subset of C, and so Z naught is a point inside this. Okay. So we say f is differentiable at Z naught. So the same usual definition. You can do this f of Z naught minus Z naught, Z minus Z naught, and you just take the quotient of this and take the limit Z tends to Z naught. Okay. If this exists. And if so, then you define this to be f dash of, so then you define this to be f dash of z naught is the limit, right? Now, when I say the limit exists, so I have to look at this. So you have to look at the you have to look at the distance between two points, and you want to take a limit in this sense, right? So basically, if you go to the epsilon delta definition of limit, core definition of limit, you realize that this set should contain. So if you want to take a limit at say z naught, right? So there will be a smaller ball. If you want to take the limit in this set, there will be a small. Okay, so I have not introduced that notation, I guess. Anyway, so you can. So if I just define like this, so such that z minus z naught is less than r. You want a sufficiently small r so that this is inside omega. Okay. So this definition of derivative itself demands your omega to be open. So by open, now what I mean is there is a ball of smaller, small enough radius which is contained inside the set. Okay. So you really don't need to bother about it, but you just have to realize that if you have to take the limit, there's such a thing, such a ball. Now this is a ball or a disk which is centered at z naught and radius at most r, so this strictly less than r. So this has to be inside the, this b naught, br z naught has to be inside your set omega. If we just have to make sure this happens. Okay. So once you have defined this derivative, so we said f is differentiable at z naught, and we write f dash of z naught. Now what we want to say is what is called a holomorphic function. So f is holomorphic. So on D, if f is differentiable at every z naught in z naught, okay, every z naught in disk. So if you have the, so if you your f is I have written it incorrectly, morphic. Yeah. So if your f is differentiable on every point inside the disk, then that f is called holomorphic. So so just naming convention right now. So these holomorphic functions have some very interesting property, and they're very rigid compared to your, so this derivative definition of this derivative is nothing but your the way you define the real derivatives as well, but this on complex plane, this they are quite rigid, and in fact quite beautiful if you can look at them, but it's quite difficult to really look at them. So this has to be there. So you start with omega and omega. So everything that I'm going to look at the sets are non-empty. So don't really bother about that technicality. So everything is non-empty. All sets are non-empty right now. And what we are looking at, so, okay. So let me go to the first big result, which is kind of the main result of, so this is called a mean value property. So R is, let's say, in between 0 to 1, okay, and F is holomorphic. Right now, for me, the domains are only disk. I am not going to talk about any other domain. So domain means where the function is defined. So I'm only going to talk about holomorphic function on disks. Okay. So let's say R is small enough. So this is also not enough, but R is small enough, let's say, such that this B naught R is inside the disk. So what you can do is you can look at an average. Okay, so let me just write it down first. Yeah. So What I mean to say, if you take a, if you are considering the open unit disk, right? So let's say this is your open unit disk, that is one. So this is one, let's say. So you take a point Z naught, and there is a small enough neighborhood of this, small enough disk centered at Z naught. So R equal I theta will give you the R is small enough. This will give you the boundary of this. Yeah. So what you are doing it, you are averaging this function out on the circle, on the boundary of the circle. This is inside the disk. And what you get is the mean, is the midpoint of the disk, right? So this is your Z naught. This dot point. So this is a very small here to see, but this dot is Z naught. So this is called a mean value property. So this is, you may have seen, I mean, you must have seen the mean value property of real numbers, and this also you, some of you must have seen. And this is the core part of when you start the holomorphic study of holomorphic function. This is Cauchy's approach. So this is something which will tie all these things together. So once you have this mean value property, what follows next is called a maximum modulus principle. So a good okay. So one more thing to maybe so people to think about is what other functions will satisfy mean value property. So what I just said is if you have a holomorphic function on a disk, then it will satisfy mean value property. Now can you so it's a good it's not an exercise, but I mean one can think about where they have seen such a thing. Maybe thinking C not in C but R2 functions in 2D to 2D, some functions like that, and try to when you are doing multivariable calculus, maybe then you can see to try to see where else you can find mean value property. And there, if you really find it, you'll realize the maximum modulus principle holds there as well. So what is maximum modulus principle says? So if you have a holomorphic function F, so just vaguely I can write is that F is holomorphic on disk. And let F is non-constant. It will be non-constant. Okay, so you can take constant as well. Doesn't matter, but just to be making the proof or statement easier, you can take X to be non-constant. So you have a holomorphic function which is not a constant function. Okay, so such a function cannot have a local maxima. So what does that mean? So locality is something like this. So you start with a point. Okay, so here is a picture. I wish I could have drawn a bigger one. But the locality is something like this. Okay, so you start here. So if you, for Z naught, this is one particular locality of Z naught, right? So in this locality, F of Z naught cannot hold a maxima. That is, if I start Z, you take F in this particular locality. So, okay. If this happens, okay. So if this happens, then we say F of Z naught is a local maxima. So any point inside this locality will be dominated by F of Z naught value. The value of F of Z will be dominated by, the modulus of F of Z should be dominated by modulus of F of Z naught. That's a local maxima for us. What it says, the theorem says, or the principle says, that holomorphic functions cannot have local maxima. Okay. So I'll just show, briefly tell you what this has to, I mean, if somebody is working on pen and paper, you might have just started realizing how this relates to local maxima. So what you can do is, you can start here and just take modulus, right? Okay, d theta and 0 to 2 pi. So what you get is, this is same as modulus of Z naught, right? Now you have a control over R. This particular statement, you see the mean value property does not, the right hand side, there is nothing to do with R, right? So you can take, once you get a small enough neighborhood of Z naught, you can take even smaller and smaller neighborhood, whatever you want, as long as this is strictly greater than zero, and you still get your mean value back, right? So here you have to use triangle inequality to get a contradiction of sort. Okay, so here you have to use triangle inequality. So on this side is a summation, right? So you can use a triangle inequality here, and we'll get something like this. So you have to justify the triangle inequality using some analysis one, but if you know the definition of integration, that's also fine. So what you get is something like this, right? So, and Z belongs to, so I am controlling the R here. So I'm not writing different R, but I'm controlling the R here. So you have now this. So this part is assuming there is a local maxima, and this part is what you're getting from your mean value theorem. And that will give you something interesting, that on this locality, this function is constant. At this point, you have two paths, two things to do. As of now, there is no contradiction, of course. So here you have two things to do. One is, if you have done complex analysis just a little bit, so we'll use identity theorem. Okay. Or if you have a bit of topology, so you use the property of disk to be connected. Okay. So if you go, maybe after the talk, if somebody looks up this particular proof of this particular theorem, most of them will use identity theorem, but most of the books use identity theorem afterwards. But I think connectedness has more to do with this, because even the identity theorem uses connectedness of the disk to be proven. So it's better to look at a topological point of view, starting with the connectedness of disk. Anyway, so what we have, what we have established, suppose you can prove this, I mean, you can use these two to get a contradiction. What you have established, there is no, unless f itself is a constant function. Okay, so unless f is a constant function, it cannot attain the local maxima in, it cannot attain the local maxima on disk, right? So maximum modulus is there. So what follows maximum modulus principle is called a Schwarz lemma. Okay, Schwarz lemma. And this is where the this is the starting point. I mean the root, or so the root of the peak interpolation that I wanted to talk about is here, Schwarz lemma, and not peak interpolation. So Ashani was talking about hyperbolic spaces, I guess. So this thing branches out to a lot, so many different objects. So one of them is the peak interpolation. So what does Schwarz lemma say is, okay, you start with f is holomorphic. Okay. I want to give a name to this particular class of functions, all the functions which are holomorphic from disks to, okay, so this bar means I've also included the boundary, it's a closed disk, okay, so I've also included the boundary of the disk, this is not this is not the adjoint or conjugate bar, this is this bar of closure, so, okay, so you have included the boundary as well, so now if you have a holomorphic function here, so I want to name this, so I'll call this class as Schur class. Okay. And who is Schur and why we call it Schur class is a different story, but let's just keep it as Schur class right now. So remember what we started with, the interpolation I wanted to talk about, we'll have two things. One, we have a domain, we need two domains, and we need a class of functions. So our class of function that we are going to deal is this Schur class of function. And it's usually notated with the script S, and with handwriting that script S, I hope you follow this is a script S. Okay. It's called Schur class. okay, so we have the Schur class of function, and Schwarz lemma says if f of 0 is 0, right, then you have two things. One is modulus of f of z is less than or equal to mod z for all z in the disk. And number two is f dash of 0 is less than or equal to 1. So this tells you, this itself will, first of all, you can see this is a very rigid condition. So this is not a huge deal right now. I'll tell you why this is not a huge deal in a moment, and that this function should fix 0, f of 0 is 0. But you get this inequality is interesting. Note that this z that we have taken, if you take the function z, okay, so let take the function z is identity function, right? From this is a function from disk to disk. And so if you take any point, it goes to itself. So like any point will go to itself, right? The identity function z. So z is in the Schur class because the modulus of z is of course less than or equal to 1. And it also fixes 0, so 0 will go to 0. Right? So what essentially this this part of the lemma says that this function z is somewhat in some sense universal. Okay, so in some sense universal, as in it dominates all the functions. The modulus dominates all the functions, which vanishes at 0. Right, and the universality is of this sense. Like if suppose, okay, so this inequality, the I'll just talk about the first. The second one is also the same one. Then the inequality in one is strict. Other than where 0, of course, you know f of 0 is 0, right? So it's strict for z not equal to 0. And if suppose it is not strict, like if suppose there exists a z, right, which is non-zero, which is inside your disk, and f of z is equal to modulus of f of z is equal to modulus of z, then f has to be some gamma times z, or f of z has to be some gamma times z, where gamma is from the circle. Modulus of, is a scalar, it's a complex number, whose modulus is 1. So this is the universality. That is, there is up to rotation, there is no other, okay, so anyway, so there is no other functions which has this property in the Schur class, right? And here, now we'll go to this particular part, is this part of why I said that the zero is not very important, because what follows is called a Schur-Pick lemma, where you do not really want this zero anymore. So not Schur, sorry, Schwarz-Pick lemma. Okay, so what does Schwarz-Pick lemma says? So you start with any f, again in Schur class. So f is in the Schur class. Remember what the Schur class is? A holomorphic functions from disk to closure of disk. Okay, and so if you start with the Schur class and you take two points inside the disk, then modulus of f of z, this will be a bit of surprise to you. When it's kind of complicated looking expression, but won't be that complicated once you get into it, but fine. Okay, excuse me, because writing it may like this may give you some wrong indications, but it is. So what I'll do is I'll z is usually taken as variable, right? So if I just put a z bar, you may get a wrong indication, but so. Okay, so if you start a function in Schur class, what it says, Schwarz-Pick lemma, what it says, if you start with the function in Schur class, then the functions will satisfy this condition. And this might look a bit surprising. This is a very weird looking condition. So, but maybe some of you might have seen this right hand side, but let me just introduce this guy to you. So if you define, So what I'm doing here Yes. Okay, I'm really bad at the CF. So anyway, so if you fix a point W and you define this function SW of Z, what you're looking at is this function will map disk to disk. It's called Möbius transformation. So yeah, let's not go into that. But what it does is it will take you can see straightforward that zero will map to under this SW, zero will go to W, and W will go to zero, right? It's a very interesting function, and this is this part is what we want to look at right now. So if suppose your function, look at this expression. So just look at this expression. If suppose you fix this z1 and your function f of z1, so suppose that f of z1 is 0. So suppose what this particular expression, the Schwarzschild lemma, tells you is if f of z1 is 0, then modulus of f of z is less than or equal to for all z, right? So this is, so basically you have to put f of z1 equal to 0 and you get this, right? So what is going on here? So this guy here, this hw that I've written, in particular in this case h of z1 z, this is a universal dominator. This will dominate every function in Schur class which vanishes at z1 in this case, right? And you also have the universality, the Schwarzschild condition is also strict for any two points z1 not equal to z2. So if you choose z1 is not equal to z2, then this Schwarzschild condition, right, is strict. That is, the inequality is strict. Okay, and if not, if you find two different points so that the Schwarzschild condition is an equality, then you get a similar expression that your f is nothing but this transformation SW. If suppose there are two points which are not equal and SP is not strict, that is the equality holds for two distinct points, then our f has to be of some gamma times, so I'm writing f for some W, right? And this gamma is of course the same type of gamma modulus, this is one. That is the universality of this kind of operators, I mean this kind of functions. So this is where the Schwarzschild lemma lies. In fact, what we are going to do now is just state the interpolation. Where is the interpolation in all this? So let me look at this particular guy right now. Where is the interpolation in all this? So look at this condition. Okay, so look at this condition. Suppose you want to find a function f in the Schur class which interpolates something, let's say which interpolates your z1, which interpolates z1 to, let's say, w1 and z2 to w2, right? You want such an interpolant with some Schur function f, right? Then f of this, if you replace here f of z1 equal to w1 and f of z2 equal to w2, you get what is called it's a necessary condition. So you have a necessary condition for an interpolation. You cannot do a random interpolation. Now you know that this has to be done. And this Schwarzschild lemma, if you use your Schwarz lemma and do necessary adjustment with this function, then you get the Schwarzschild lemma. So you have to go to you have to check how to prove Schwarzschild lemma using Schwarz lemma. So you have to use this function. The hint is use this function. Okay. How to use this function is up to your imagination, but it's not very difficult to figure out how to use it. Okay, so basically what we are having is an necessary condition. What is that necessary condition? If such an interpolation exists in the Schur class, you should have w1 minus w2 upon 1 minus W1 bar, W2 bar, W2 modulus should be less than or equal to So this is a necessary condition now. So at least we have a necessary condition for interpolation. If such an interpolation exists, the Schwarzschild lemma says the necessary condition should be satisfied. Now I will take a very big leap of faith. I will just write down your Nevelin-Pick interpolation and or pick Nevelin as I said, but I mean, if you go alphabetically, you can write Nevelin-Pick interpolation. It's easier to remember. Some people say pick Nevelin interpolation. Some people say Nevelin-Pick interpolation, but it is all the same. So suppose you start with your data points in disk and your target points inside your disk, right? Then what you have, the following are equivalent. Number one, there exists a so there exists a function f in Schur class s. Yes? Okay, so there exists f in Schur class such that f of zi is equal to wa for all I. Number two, what you have is let me write down the expression. I'll just explain what this all means. Okay, so what does this second expression? The first one is, of course, your the following are equivalent means like this. This is a necessary and sufficient condition. Okay, so so suppose there is a function f in the Schur class. Which interpolates zi to wi, then you have a matrix. This is a matrix, right? So this is a matrix. So you write down n by n matrix with entries here. So for example, if you have two points, So for I'll just keep this condition. So for example, if you have two data points, you will have something like I minus w1 w1 upon like. So I hope you can see this is a matrix. It's not, I'm just making a fuss of it writing up, but anyway. Right, so this is what your 2x2 matrix. If you have 2 points, this is a 2x2 matrix going to look like. Right. So this what this second condition says, this matrix is a positive matrix. So what is a positive matrix? This says it's a positive matrix. Okay. So I'll tell you what a positive matrix is, but it has to do with the matrices. So it's a the condition, these two conditions. So see, this is a complex analysis condition, right? This condition, first condition is purely complex analytic. Like you're finding a function which is holomorphic and it does something, it has some interpolant property. The second condition is linear algebraic. So you have, this is how beautiful this particular object is. And there are other things I wanted to include, but I'll just skip. I mean, I'll not tell about them right now. So let's just see what's a positive matrix, then we can move forward. So what is a positive matrix? So the positive matrix is something like this. If you have a matrix, let's say n by n matrix. Right? So if you have n by n complex matrix, what's a positive matrix? You have a row matrix. You have a so. So if you have a so A is said to be positive, right? So I mean, so this is positive. A is positive. if you have a for any row matrix X, let's say you have X A X star is positive. So this is you take adjoint and take the conjugate of it. So it's X A X star is positive, right? So that for any X in this. So this is what a positive matrix is in the language of matrix. If you want to write it in terms of vectors in a product space, there's a way to write it there. Of course, in but this is what we mean by positivity. And if you go back a bit, so the Navalny-Napier interpolation is dealing with positive matrices and analytic functions, right? So this is what it has to do. Now, if you have a good look at this, I'll just go to the next part of the talk, which is very brief. In a sense, there are lots of things which are a little bit more, so to say, advanced, but they are not really that difficult once you know the definitions. So I don't want to introduce so many things. So that's why I'll just very briefly go through all these things. Hilbert space. So Hilbert space theory, where like what I have said right now, there is, so Navalny-Napier interpolation. So there is an interpolation result. You have interpolant if and only if something happens. I did not talk about uniqueness here right now, but the uniqueness part is also there. There is also method for it. But what I said is solvability, when it is solvable. Okay. Now, where does the Hilbert space theory come in the picture? So the Hilbert space theory comes in through a person known as how do you write Donald? So anyway, Saracen. So Saracen is enough, I think. If you don't want Donald, so D Saracen. Okay, Saracen is enough. So it comes into picture by somebody called Saracen. Here I want to give a small, very small history. Put some history into it. So the result just I showed you, it was done by Pick. I'll give a pick. So Pick did it in 1916. These data I do remember quite well. Then it was Navalny, who was quite younger to Pick. There are so many N's, 3 N's, 4 N's in his name, Navalny, who proved this in 1919. And some of you might realize that this was a time when the First World War was going on, and you'll find this story in every single book who talks about Pick-Navalny interpolation, that these two persons, they were residing in different places where they could not communicate due to the First World War. And they both of them proved this theorem, or they were investigating into this, and both of them gave different proofs of this theorem. Okay, so what really happened is Pick gave the solvability, Navalny what gave a method of proving it. So he parameterized the solution. So they solved the problem in two different ways. And that was, and later on, I mean, so many people have gone through Pick's direction and Navalny's direction, and there is such beautiful theory of both the directions. Anyway, so Pick Navalny did like this. And quite some time later, so Belanash, so this, and Adam Kurani, well, maybe Kurani spelling I might have missed up a bit, but anyway, so Adam Kurani and Belanas, around, I think, something around in the late 50s, 1958, 59, something like that. So they were, so there is a reason to be believe there is a good connection into operator theory, and they were trying to prove this inside operator theory, and they had some success, but not complete. And later came Donald Saracen. I think this is in something around 1968. He gave a very interesting proof of, very short, in fact, quite short proof of this Pick-Navalny interpolation. But the theory was used as completely abstract, completely operator theoretic. There was no function theory, I mean, not much of function theory in it. Okay, so I'll just be very, now everything is going to be quite abstract. So. So even if you don't follow it, it's fine. Just listen to it as a story. Okay. So what's going on here is we start with something called a kernel function. Okay, what is a kernel function? Kernel function is something of a two-variable function. So you have a two-variable function, let's say some domain. There's no need to omega on here right now. Okay, so you start with the kernel function C. Right. So this, then for any finitely many points z1 up to zn, okay, you take any finitely many point in omega, then this matrix k zi zj is positive. Right. For any finitely many point, this is positive, then it is called a kernel function. Now you can start to see what is how this relation has to be there, because we are dealing with a positive function, certain kind of positivity in two variable functions, right? And here we start with what is called a kernel function. So there is a very good reason to believe that they are linked. Not very good, but there's some reason to believe that they are linked. So I will not go into deeply into theory of kernel function, but people who are probably doing data science might have seen this. Maybe real kernel functions, and they are used throughout right now. So many places they are used. So what we are going to look at is a space which is L2 of n. What is this space? So this is a sequence space. So you have sequences such that summation mod of a n square is finite. Okay, so you take this L2 of n. Now for me, n includes zero. So what I mean by here, you start with zero to infinity. So if you have this kind of space, there is a certain kernel function. You can straight away see if your set is n, right? So you look at n cross n, and you look at this function delta, and then, right? You see. Basically, what I mean by that is this is equal to 0 if n not equal to n, and is equal to 1 if n equal to. Okay. Equal to one. So this is the delta function. So that is the kernel function. This is quite very obvious kernel function, which is not of much use right now. But just to realize what a kernel function is, you can check with this. And any finite CN also, you can find this. In fact, you can start with any positive matrix of and check whether it's a kernel function of some set, which set you have determined. The set is important. How you are looking at the kernel function. So I'll just briefly write down what. So Indra, how much longer I can go? Anyway, I started quite late, I guess. So can you tell me how much longer I go? I can go.
Yes, you can continue. I mean, you have time.
Yeah. Okay. So let's look at this space right now. L2 of n. Okay, so I want to do an association, some kind of an association. So let me start with this sequence for now. Wait, no need to go here, right? Okay, so let's use give some property of kernel function that will be used, and we can do this. So kernel function has some very interesting property. What is called a reproducing property. Okay, so I'll not explain, I mean, I'll not define what's the reproducing property, example of it. Okay, so what is an example of that reproducing property? Is I will go through this particular space L2n in its one incarnation, and we'll look at it. So let me do this association first. Okay, so what I'm doing here is I'm taking something in L2 of n, right? And I'm writing a power series. So this is called a power series, right? So I'm writing a power series with this. And then you have to make sense of convergence. What does this right-hand side mean, right? So much of analysis is just making sense of this convergence. So whatever you write a full sum, when does that make sense? So much of earlier analysis is just making sense of it. So so you have started with an and assume that this makes sense. Okay, makes sense not anywhere, it makes sense on disk. So if I put an element here, so if you evaluate it z equal to, let's say some w inside the disk, then this makes sense for us. So mathematically, those people who have gone through complex analysis, they know this is called an analytic function. If there is, and there is a domain of convergence, and one can show the way we have chosen that an, which have square summability, these are going to be analytic on the disk. All the functions are going to be analytic on the disk. And then the further, there is a different point of view. As I said, complex analysis is like the elephant, which is many point of view. What I just gave in the beginning is holomorphic functions, and that's the idea of, I think that's how Cauchy developed his theory. Then there's the idea of Weierstrass, where you go through convergence and of polynomials. And so here what you see, this analytic function is basically convergent polynomial. So what you're looking, the very first core theorem of complex analysis is that holomorphic functions are analytic, analytic functions are holomorphic. So they are one and the same, but technically they are different, they have different definition, but they are, for complex analysis, they are the same thing. Okay, anyway, so what you're looking at right now is this identification, right? And now look at a particular example. So you start with the element in disk, I will start with lambda bar. Okay, what is lambda bar? So if lambda is equal to x plus iy, then lambda bar is nothing but x minus i. Okay, you start with lambda bar, that is still inside the disk, you can see. Then lambda bar power n is inside L2 of n, right? Because what you get is summation lambda bar power n is 1 by 1 minus lambda bar. So this is again, so I'll not write 0 to infinity every time, I'll just put n here, and that also should make sense. And if you go and look up when analytic function makes sense, you realize that there is no need to put n equal to 0 to infinity. In any order it will work. Okay, so anyway, so what I have is 1 upon 1 minus this, right? So now let's look at this particular identification that I've done. So what you get is, this lambda bar power n z power n, which is equal to 1 by 1 minus, so this is a geometric series, so you don't need to, I think most of us really know this geometric series that we are writing here. So this is an analytic function. So if you look at a differentiability point of view, so this function only vanishes when z is equal to 1 upon lambda bar, right? And lambda bar is inside the disk, so 1 upon lambda bar is going to be outside the disk, and it will be little farther, so from the disk. So what you get is this function is in fact differentiable. If you think in a real analysis point of view, and that translates here as well, so this is differentiable. Okay, so this particular example that I've taken has a very interesting property. For that property, I want to introduce two operators. So what I started is said is that I have to deal with operators, so not Hilbert spaces themselves. So there are two operators, basic operator. One is backward shift and the other one is forward shift. So backward shift is, if you start with a sequence, let's say an, so I'll write in a very, write in the easiest possible way, which is not usually preferred writing, but anyway. So you start with a0, a1, something like this. This is a sequence. We start with a0, a1 is there up to an, and goes on like that. So if you put a backward shift, what you will get is a1, a2, right? So like this. Then what's the forward shift? You start with the sequence a0, a1, I'll write a1 right now. So what you will get is first element will become 0, then you start with a0, a1. Okay. So this is the, this is the first example that if you do operator theory or study infinite dimensional cases, this is the first example you look at, because of this makes use of the infinite dimensionality. So you look at this particular example, this particular expression, the forward shift, you do not lose any of the coordinates, right? You introduce a zero coordinate, you do not lose any of the coordinates. You cannot do this particular, this thing inside your finite dimensional spaces, in a sense that you have to, if you shift a coordinate system. So for those who understand linear algebra and coordinate system, so if you shift a coordinate system and introduce a zero, you'll lose something. In this case, you are not losing any coordinate by shifting it. And this is the famous Hilbert's example of infinite rooms. So you can shift it. There are so many availability, you can shift it always. These two are, quite fundamental objects and a very interesting object as well. I will see it in this particular example. So if you do a backward shift on this sequence, lambda by power n, what will it do? So what is this lambda by power n sequence? I'll write it again. So you start with lambda by power 0, and that is constant function 1, right? So lambda by power 1, and so lambda by power square, and so on and so forth. So if you're doing a backward shift, you can check. I mean, this is not very difficult or nothing to do with. So it's very easy to see that this is nothing but this. You get a lambda, extra lambda bar, right? So you do a backward shift. The first constant function 1 goes away. Lambda 1 becomes the first coordinate. And then you take the lambda bar out and you get this. Now, those who have done some linear algebra can see this is telling you if this function b is a linear operator, which it is, you can check. This is telling you that this lambda bar power n is in fact an eigen vector with eigenvalue lambda bar. And this happens for every point inside the disk. This is a very interesting property this function has. The sequence has, and the second one is, I'll just go up a bit. Yeah, where was the identification? If you look at this identification, remember this identification because I have a limited space, so I'll just write it in the site. If you have this identification, suppose you take a function, I'll write it here so that this identification is here. So if you state a function f of z, is equal to, suppose you have this something like this, okay, and this is inside this right hand side identification. Okay, I've not told you what the space is, but assume this makes sense. Okay, so suppose you have this, then what is f of lambda? F of lambda is nothing but not for any lambda in the disk, right? So that's a point evaluation what you do. Now you remember how this inner product is defined usually, or if you don't want to know inner product, how so you have this thing. Take an as a column, as a row vector, and you look at lambda bar transpose. So the way the square sum ability is defined, so this is equal to the whole bar. Okay. That's how you define this. This is called an inner product, but you can think as a row matrix multiplying with the infinite column matrix, right? And you do a conjugation at that time when you multiply. That's called an inner product here. So this point evaluation corresponds to this inner product. This is a point evaluation. What you are doing is you are evaluating f at lambda, right? And that corresponds to this inner product. This is what the inner product is, and usually written like this. Okay, so usually written with this rectangle, I mean this angled bracket. Okay, so nothing very special. What you are doing is you have a column vector, you have a row vector, you do a multiplication, and you have a conjugation in place. So that's very special about this particular vector. And as I said, the second thing is that it has this eigenvalue property. Yeah. Now what you see is, suppose you have two points, let's say lambda 1 and lambda 2 in your disk, right? Suppose you have two points. Now consider, I've not these two sequences, lambda 1 power n and lambda 2 power n. Okay, for convenience sake, let me give them names. So let me call this k lambda 1 and let me call this k lambda 2, right? So this k lambda 1 and k lambda 2 both are in L2 of n. And if I apply b on k lambda 1, I got lambda 1 bar k lambda 1, and b of k lambda 2 was lambda 2 bar of k lambda 2, right? This is what we got. Now here what I want to do is I want to create a space out of it. Let me call it Q, which is something like this, k lambda 1 plus beta k lambda 2. K lambda 2, alpha betas are linear complex. Okay, so this is a two-dimensional vector space. Okay, so if you're not comfortable in vector space, fine, just follow what's going on a bit. So try to follow what's going on a bit. So you have a two-dimensional vector space, which is generated by these two elements, these two vectors, k lambda 1 and k lambda 2. And this is inside, this is subspace of L2 of n, right? And what you have is B of Q is contained inside Q. In fact, it is equal to Q. So nothing special here because it's just shifting it, right? So so if you know little bit of vector space theory, that eigenspaces are fixing the space itself, so it will be inside this. Second, suppose you define another particular, I'll just tell some jargons, maybe that if you don't follow it is fine. So you have to introduce an operator here. So on this space, if you define, let's say phi, right? So what is phi acting on k lambda will do is it will do something like this. So you fix two points and disk. Okay, you can take it in the closure as well, doesn't matter where you take it, but because of my show class, I'm taking like this. So, and it defined like this. Right, and you extend this linearly, right? So you know what it does to these two vectors. And once, if you can check, which is not very difficult with this exam, with this particular expression that I've taken, that they are linearly independent, you can extend this linearly, this operator, to this space Q. And second thing, what you will see, once you see this, once you check it, you'll see that if you apply B first and then Q, or you apply first pi and then B on Q, doesn't matter. So once you define this operator, you can check that this phi indeed commutes with your backward shift, or it intertwines the backward shift. Okay. So once you have this, what I've done is actually I've given, so in this I have associated a particular phi which has something like this. So it takes lambda 1 to lambda 2. I've just defined a function and two points, that's all, right? And this particular function has this property that it intertwines this. Here comes what Saracen does. Saracen says something like, now I'll do a bit of a picture, which is, I'll just draw this picture and then I'll explain what is going on. So suppose you have phi here, then there will be some phi here, and this is an inclusion map of Q, is an inclusion map of Q. Okay. So what Saracen says is, suppose you have a phi here in Q, then you can, this is called a lifting, you can lift into the bigger space. So we have defined something on a smaller space on Q. You can lift it onto the bigger space L2 of N, and this has some property. What is that property? That this will also intertwine in the bigger space. Okay, so this lifting keeps intertwiners to intertwiners. So you start with an intertwiner, it will lift to an intertwiner, and this diagram commutes. Okay, so this IQs are inclusion maps. So they have some, there is some significance to inclusion maps right now. So they are inclusion maps, and this diagram commutes. Okay. So that's what Saracen says. So this is known as Saracen's interpolation, or dilation, committed lifting, not dilation. Saracen's committed lifting, and then there's a general version of it. But we are interested in this. So what I wanted to say is this phi corresponds to Schur class. That is, if you give me this phi, once you have this lifting, give me this phi, then this phi, there exists a function I don't really want to explain in detail, but this phi corresponds to element in Schur class along with this identification. The identification I just did here So the kind of identification we are doing here, like taking sequences and putting in them the power series, right? So you have certain identification with this phi. So that is where this comes. So there is an identification. So the abstract, now I'll just show you, write down the abstract thing. What this positivity and all these things has to do here. So there is an, so the Schur class will correspond to multipliers. Okay, so never mind, that is not necessary. But this is what the whole idea is. Where positivity comes into play is, as I said, the kernels are defined positively. So on, there are something called multipliers on kernel spaces. Okay, and these element that we're looking at are multiplier, and there is a positivity there. So if you want to describe something, so you have just an idea is if you are looking at something like this. Okay, so what this, if and only if, is a contraction. Or a star, it doesn't matter. This is a core idea between in that positivity, but I don't want to go into this. The positivity relation that you get for peak interpolation is coming out of this. But the main idea is here. What you can do is you can do a lifting. That allows you for lifting. And I'll stop the maths here, and I'll just go through a bit of how this thing has, what is that elephant I started with, and how this whole lifting thing has played a huge role in operator theory. So, so what is going on is you start with two subspaces, closed subspaces. You have a particular operator, then you can lift it, right? So now, after Saracen did his lifting, well, Nash and Foyas did something called a commutant lifting, and they generalized it. Okay, so that is not I wanted to talk about. What I want to talk say is what is this peak Nevelina property is. So, as a blind man, what you are looking at is solvability of a problem. Right? Now, what Saracen actually did is asking what is the intrinsic property of the problem. Okay. Not in this word, but yes, it kind of says, okay, this problem is in fact a commutant lifting. So he says this is how it is related. Now what happens years later, in early 90s, like 1991 or 89, something like that, another mathematician known as operator theory, Jim Magler, what he says, if suppose you can do in this particular setup in L2N and the way I have defined K lambda and all, what other setup you can do this commutant lifting, and you have, in what other setup we can ask interpolation problem. Okay, so he has some complex analysis, analytics function spaces, and he's asking whether this kind of positivity condition will give you interpolation problem. So what you are looking at is not the interpolation problem itself, what you are looking at when these necessary and sufficient condition will occur. Okay, so the solvability condition that you are looking at, that itself is a property right now. So there comes a theory of what is called a complete Nevelina peak kernel and lifting there, and Agler has done, I mean, wonderful work there, and then he has what is now called a Schur-Agler class, like where you do interpolations. That is just one way of looking at this, and there are other way, I mean, it won't stop anytime soon. I think I'll stop here because the more I speak, the more I confuse others. So, yeah. Hello?
Hello?
Yeah.
Yeah, so thank you, Deepak, for your
talk. I'm very thankful for all of you to like just being there because it's,
any questions from any questions?
Yes, sir. I'm a first year undergraduate student, so I actually don't know what is a kernel. So can you explain that?
Yeah. So. Okay. So. I mean, it, of course, it doesn't have to be first or second derivative or anything. It's not very common. Kernel functions are not very common use in mathematics, but it's high time that we should introduce it. And yeah, so people in data science do use it very often right now. So what is a kernel? A kernel is a two-variable function. Okay. And you define a matrix out of it. As I said, so if you have a two-variable function, you can write it like this, right? Kz1, z1, and kz2, what is this, 1, 2, and so on and so forth. And given any number of points, you can write a matrix like this. Z11, Z12, Z13, something, keep on going like this. And you demand this to be always to be positive. Positive as a matrix. So first you have to understand what's a positive matrix. Once you understand what is a positive matrix, the kernel function is defined in a way that every time you write a matrix like this, it has to be positive. That's called a kernel function. What is the importance of it? With every kernel function, there is a Hilbert space attached to it. And Hilbert, not just any Hilbert space, Hilbert space of functions attached to it. And then you can traverse back and forth that every Hilbert space of function having the particular that property will give you the
kernel. That kernel function is called the reproducing kernel.
Yeah. So I really didn't want to tell that reproducing part. I have written it, but again, so the reproducing part, what sir is talking about, you have a kernel function. And it will give you what is called a function space, let's say HK, which will contain functions, some functions, let's say. And you have this, there is a element inside this function space where you can reproduce the values at each lambda.
Exactly.
It's a function space in some domain that is called reproducing kernel. So with kernel function, you have reproducing kernel. And so what I would suggest you to look at is not, maybe not exactly kernel function, but if you are doing linear algebra, I'm just going a little down. If you're doing linear algebra, so what I'm suggesting you to look at is you start with a positive, first you see what's a positive matrix. And once you know what's a positive matrix, look at these particular expressions. Okay, so you look at this. So X is a column vector, you look at the transpose of this. And try to see what these things are. So, and if X is a variable, what do you get? What is the image of X and so on and so forth? And you realize how this is related to what is inner product and norm. So that is probably the starting point. So how it relates to that? Yeah.
Do you have any question?
Yes, sir. Sir, this generalization is like totally based on the hard disk.
Your voice is not clear.
Sorry, it's not audible. Yeah.
Abhishek, you write on chat box. Abhishek, you can use this chat box.
Yep. Oh, I want to suggest something now. That is, we have had so many lectures through a webinar or otherwise, so many people. Why not, before the webinar, we request the speaker to send some kind of write-up of it. It not be the whole of it, some sort of summary, which you can take, list them. In future, you can tell, I may organize these events with these write-ups. Because write-ups will tell you what are the areas and what are the things that has been done. That will be helpful. In fact, this one was an excellent lecture in the sense that this could be some sort of a motivation for further research for so many of your students and for some of the hopefuls for PhD and people. And similarly, Ashanti's lectures were similarly very useful. And like that. Many of them were very good. And if we request the speaker to send just a small write-up of the whole thing, whatever it is, it will not be exhaustive, but it will be some sort of a abstract or brief summary of it, that will be useful. How do you like that?
Yeah, definitely. That's like, from my point of view, I think it would be, if I can, I could have written something in advance, because I'm assuming all zero and then building up. So, I mean, at least I can assume some context.
You are not forewarned, so you are not given a warning earlier. So, that's all right. But you see, the thing is, now that you have spoken, and many interesting things came up. And so, why not we do this?
Yeah.
After all, it is not just we're holding a seminar for the heck of it.
Yeah. So I'll do something. I'll do a write-up of this.
But
I can send it to...
We have also people who are going to speak about it in future.
Yes,
also the people who have already spoken, we can always request them.
Mm-hmm.
How do you like
that? Sir, yeah, that seems to be a very nice idea, I guess. Sir, I just wanted to... I forgot to put a thing, I mean, name something. So I just want the students to look at the book of Barry Simon, new ones. Okay.
Yeah.
So...
Oh, yeah, Barry Simon's.
I mean, I thought... So, yeah, which one, of course. So, yeah, so why I was laughing when he said, hey, which one? Because he has written so many things. So it's natural to ask Barry Simon which one.
You see, he wrote Treatise on Analysis and something like that.
Yeah, okay. So this is a new, I think
new
it
series.
Came, this is a new series, AMS new series, which came very recently.
Yeah.
So I think 2012 or something like that. So it says it has five parts of analysis, basically. So what I was thinking is just to tell about the complex analysis part.
Yeah.
Just Barry Simon has a book on complex analysis. So this is a very new book, AMS series. So just look for complex analysis. There are two parts. One is called 2A and 2B. 2A is for basic complex analysis. So it's AMS series, I think. And the second 2B is advanced complex analysis. You look at, anybody can look at this 2A part. Is 2A. So what
that's
is interesting is Barry Simon writes a lot.
That'll be very good.
Yeah. So what I wanted to say is Barry Simon writes a lot. What he did in this particular book, it's a big fat book. So he has a comparison of different approach to basic complex analysis.
Yes.
So what I showed you today is cautious approach. Then there is a Westra's approach of analytic functions. And he compares all of them. He talks about all these approaches. And the second book I want to say, which I don't know how we missed it in our MSc days or BSc days, is Complex Analysis by Saracen. So these two are two books in two like separate spectrum. Like Barry Simon writes a lot, Saracen writes very little. I mean, so Saracen's book is like some 80-90 pages.
Yeah. Saracen's book on for Complex Analysis has an Indian edition.
Yeah, as an so Kim, I think Hindustan book is yeah.
So, and Barry Simon, you know, in the earlier volume 1, 2, 3, 4, that was very good.
Simon and Reed, is it? Yeah.
No, found yes.
Simon and Reed.
And yes, Indra.
Yes, Abhishek, you want to ask the question, right?
Sir, am I audible, sir?
Yes.
Yes, sir. As this generalization was basically like we know about the Hardy space, actually. So, can you please provide this convergence on, like, is this possible of the convergence in the upper half plane as it was in the disk model, sir? Like, an overview, sir.
Convergence? I didn't get your question, actually. Convergence in upper half plane of?
There was the convergence of this, like, space of the holomorphic function in the disk model, in the basically like the reproducing kernel space in the upper part, yeah, where the kernel function was measured. So.
Okay, so hard space of the upper half, this is I have not seen
sir, the upper half plane, sir. Upper half plane, sir.
Yeah, yeah. So no, yeah. In fact, that is why, you know, you can get it, because you see, if you have looked at the book of, let's say, Duren,
yeah.
HP spaces, there is one chapter on hard space on upper half plane.
Yes sir.
The part that we are using here is yeah, so this reproducing part is interested in a smaller domain, I mean where the domain is bounded, so to say.
Yes, exactly,
because the smaller the domain, the more freedom you have in reproducing sense. So
okay sir, yes sir.
Yeah, is there any
some geometric property has to be there, it's not very
small. Yeah, Pranav
has asked something.
Good evening, sir. Sir, I have a doubt, means regarding that kernel part. What we have studied is, means kernel is similar to the null space in linear mappings.
Yeah.
Okay.
But here you are associating it to a matrix. If I am not wrong.
Yeah. So let me just go to the basis of what we are talking about is the word kernel. So they are not the same object. The word is associated with two different things. For people who don't know the meaning of the word kernel, kernel means a seed.
Yeah.
So the corn, if you look at a corn, the maize, that the small that the dana, you say the dana of that maize is called a kernel. So kernels are the seeds. So that is the only similarity between the kernel of a map.
The
and
coconut,
this kernel map.
Coconut, in the coconut, the kernel is the one to which you eat.
Yes. So it's so this kernel is different. Only the word is the same. The objects are different.
Yeah, for the algebraic, I mean, in group theory, kernel means that which is goes to zero. I mean, we also have kernel in operator theory. Kernel operator is, you know, like that. The null space.
This is very unfortunate and fortunate as well. I don't know. I mean, this question has been so many times. Even when I first saw this, it was a bit of confusing, right? But it, okay. So who asked this question? I mean, what's your name?
Pranav Kumar Panda.
Pranav. Have you seen integral equations by now, by any chance?
Yeah, that's the point. That is where you have the kernel.
So
you will see maybe next year, or I mean, if you're in the first year, maybe next year you'll see, or maybe a little later as well. But you will definitely see what is called an integral equation, and there you, or if you try to do some let's say heat equation, try to solve something, or just read heat equation, it's not very difficult to read also. Just then you will see what is called a heat kernel in physics.
So we are already means studying heat equations, wave equations.
Yeah, right. So when you are solving heat equation, you have a something called a heat kernel. Right.
So what you are solving is a, you know, a differential equation.
Okay.
What you know that there was solved long ago by Fourier himself. But if you look at what you call as how to solve integral differential equations.
Via integral equation.
Yeah. PD, then you will come across this kernel. Very, you know, unfortunately, in our institute, nobody teaches a formal course on integral equations. But it should be taught.
So nowadays, very few places they do teach it in a functional analysis point of view. I mean, mostly numerical analysis point of view is there some places, but functional analysis point of view, I don't really think people are teaching. I remember Sudipta Datta took one course in IIT Kanpur. Of course, he was a master in this kind of stuff. But, yeah.
Look at this, for example. This
Yeah,
but it is interesting now. I mean, I think it is interesting. You can just go and look at kernel functions, and
okay.
If there is somebody who is doing data science, they will definitely come across this.
Yes. Yeah. So, is there any other question? Okay, so thank you, Deepak Da, for accepting our request to deliver this lecture. So it was so nice. You have started from complex analysis and you landed over the linear algebra. And yeah, so definitely our students can relate your talk because they are doing linear algebra currently, BSc students. And definitely our data science students can relate. How the analysis is very, important to data science students. So, in fact, in next semester, I'm going to teach functional analysis to data science students. So, it will be very, useful to explain to the students to how the analysis is very important to them. So, thank you, Dan.
I'll just suggest one very nice book about reproducing kernels. Basically, because this is one book which has both the functional analysis point of view as well as the data science point of view. That is by Vern Paulson. Paulson and Mrinal Raghupathy. So Paulson's student is Mrinal Raghupathy. So this is a book by Paulson and Raghupathy. So half of it is Hilbert space point of view, and the second half is data science point of view. Raghupathy right now is doing data science and computer analysis mostly, and Paulson is like a giant in
Bursavji.
Okay.
Yeah. Yes, sir. I have followed one of the notes from ISI Bangalore, sir. Like Jaydeep sir's notes, sir. It was on the reproducing. Mm-hmm. Yes, sir. So like it was a great note. Yes, sir.
The publisher is Cambridge University.
They are very costly ones.
Deepak is doing PDF under the Jaydev sir.
Yes. So I followed his notes in my internship. So I followed his notes on the hardy spaces and the reproducing kernel vector. So
he also writes a lot.
Paulson is that fellow who worked in operator theory.
Yeah, Douglas Paulson. So Douglas, people who don't, Indra, may I continue for a few minutes if you are interested? So Douglas is kind of a wizard in operator theory, and Swadhin sir you were the first student, right?
No, not the first student, one of his earlier students.
Earlier students, yeah. So, because of Swadhin sir,
second or third student.
So, he has most of the things that we are doing I am doing right now, is either related to Douglas or related to Saracen or related to Foyas. The reason that I'm here doing operator theory is because of Swadhin sir, because the way he taught and what he taught initially, and Swadhin sir, because of Swadhin sir, GM Gadadhar Mishra went to Douglas, because of Gadadhar Mishra, Jayadev Sarkar went to Douglas and Foyash, and because of that, I am with Jayadev Sarkar, and of course, discussion sometimes with GM also. So everything, all of this ties with Swadhin Patnaik and Douglas. So, it's a very small universe in that sense, yeah.
Function analysis is very great in ISI Bangalore. I talked to Muthu Kumar sir and Anish Mundayadan sir the operator theory.
It's a huge subject. It has been there for as long as analysis is. Sir, your microphone is muted.
Yes, sir, unmute yourself.
Sir, you can
unmute
In the area of operator theory, which Muthu Kumar is working, is what you call as unbounded operators, mostly, where you get all these equations of quantum mechanics, the operators of quantum mechanics, you get a spectrum, look at this point spectrum and continuous spectrum, which is
yes,
itself. And, you know, Muthu Kumar has, in fact, solved many interesting problems in this operator theory. I mean, this particularly unbounded operators.
Sorry, you're talking about...
Yeah.
Are you talking...
Sir, P. Muthu Kumar, sir. P. Muthu Kumar, sir.
Yes, yes. He's in ISI Bangalore. It begins, isn't he? Isn't P. Muthu Kumar in ISI Bangalore?
I was thinking about Muthu Kumar as a postdoc student when he said...
Yes, sir. Yes, a postdoc student, sir. Yes, a postdoc student.
Oh,
sir.
Sorry. Then I don't know.
So,
that Muthu Kumar, whom I'm talking about, was a student of Sinha.
Yes, so...
K.B. Sinha. You know K.B. Sinha, I guess.
So, Indra, is he in IIT Kanpur, right? So... there is one Muthu Kumar there, but K.V. K.V. Sinha's, his student is, no one is there in ISI, so to say.
His name is not Muthu Kumar, maybe what's his name? Some Muthu, I'm sorry.
I realized it probably mixed up. What I was saying is about Douglas and Swadhin sir and GM and Jayadev sir, everything ties down to Swadhin sir, because Swadhin sir implies then GM implied, Jayadev implied, it's going on like that, so it's a very small world in that sense.
Well, I'm proud that our first batch of students have done so well, you know. When we started, it was, we're diffident whether we can continue at all, because there was a lot of opposition from our peers, and many people wanted to kill the program of BSc itself from the beginning. But fortunately, it survived, and every batch has produced 4 or 5 PhDs. And now it is more and more every batch. So how many students have done their PhD by now, Indra? About 100, around 100 people have already done their PhD.
I thought they have completed, or I mean they are continuing their PhD.
Continuing, yes. So
that's a huge number. That's a huge number.
Huge number for a small institute with so little time. It was about 10 years because you graduated in 2009, no?
Yeah.
And it has been just, that means what? 12 years.
Mm.
I would say 11 years, because 1 year has not been over yet. And in that, there are so many boys and girls completing their PhD, continue with the PhD. Something one has to reckon with. But anyway, let's not beat our own drum. Let somebody else say this. Okay. Deepak, I'm really proud of you.
Thank you.